Let's start with a quick history. Before emoji were emoticons, the little strings of keyboard symbols used to represent expression, important tools that had already begun to expand the range of lexical meaning. The first true emoji came in 1999, created by Japanese artist Shigetaka Kurita. He worked on an early mobile platform for Japan's main mobile carrier, Docomo, to create a series of symbols that would expedite information. These icons could be selected from a keyboard-like grid and sent as separate characters, and favored symbols over faces as their primary intention was to streamline and simplify communication. The entire 176-character emoji keyboard now resides in New York's Museum of Modern Art. After quickly rising in Japan, companies outside of the country began to see the potential of emojis. In 2007, Google petitioned to get emoji recognized by the Unicode Consortium, a nonprofit group that operates like a United Nations for text standards. As computers work with numbers, characters are represented with a numeric code, but before this was standardized, text didn't necessarily show up the same across devices. Unicode accepted a proposal in 2010 to incorporate 625 emojis into their database, thus standardizing the emoji. Now you can send an emoji across competing platforms and it will be universally recognized, although always way, way more frightening if you're on a Mozilla device. As of February 2021, there are 3,136 emojis in Unicode Standard, and we're going to cover all of them in order to both explain what we're looking at and some of the history of these emoji. Here goes. The smiley face section defaults to the front of the emoji keyboard. The first four are all simple variations on the smile, with the last as a drawn representation of the texting face. Next is this face, used for nerves or close calls. Moving along, we have our laughing faces. It's worth noting that this emoji was named Oxford Dictionary's 2015 Word of the Year, the first time this was ever awarded to a pictograph. New for 2020 is the smiling face with a tear, used to show relief. Two more variations on smileys follow, as well as the angelic smile. Side note, halos have appeared across most major religions, including ancient Roman and Greek religions, Christianity, Hinduism, Buddhism, and Islam. When it surrounds not only the head but the entire figure, it is called a mandorla. Next up, we have the sarcastic ones. The flirtatious winking face and the vague relieved face follow, before a selection of romantic faces. These all convey love, although the last three are also sometimes used to express whistling. The licking lips is used for delicious food, or a delicious person, and is followed by a selection of cheeky tongue-out emojis. The skeptical face has been linked with comedian Stephen Colbert's signature expression,
"Just cut off my nose, dip me in yellow paint, and I defy you to tell the difference."
And is followed by the even more skeptical monocle face. The stereotypical nerd is next followed by the stereotypical cool guy. It's been noted that he's wearing sunglasses in the style of luxury Ray-Ban Wayfarers. A more recent edition, titled Disguised Face, depicts a face clad in the classic Groucho mask, designed on a caricature of the Marx Brothers character. Perhaps the most memorable use of the mask is by Michael Statt, who came to be known as the Groucho Bandit. After being suspected in as many as 9 Chicago bank robberies, Statt was finally sent to prison in mid-2009. After his lawyer made comments acknowledging his weight gain while awaiting trial, the judge observed dryly that he, quote, "can't pull a Groucho now." Starstruck follows, with partying, then smirking, and unamused, and then a collection of looks ranging from disappointed to distraught. We then have a selection of angry faces. Of particular interest is the last one. The symbols denoting swearing across its face are called Grolixes, a term coined by cartoonist Mort Walker in 1964 that actually appears much earlier. The first known Grolix appears on November 1st, 1901, in the comic strip Lady Bountiful. Back to our emojis, this guy of course visualizes the expression mind blown. The original term mind blown was closely connected to psychedelic drug use in the 1960s. For example, hippies were referred to as mind blown compared to more straight-laced business folk. From there, it evolved its current meaning of anyone who has experienced a mind-altering shock. Speaking of shock, we have this face next. The surprise emojis are interrupted by hot and cold before launching into a selection of surprised and distressed emojis next. Of particular note is this one, which evokes the design of Edvard Munch's famous painting, The Scream. Interestingly, according to the artist, the figure in this iconic painting isn't actually the one screaming. The scream is supposed to be emanating from the surroundings, according to Munch. He wrote, "I felt a large scream pass through nature," in German at the bottom of the 1895 piece. The figure is trying to block out the shriek they hear around them. Then we have this creepy dude giving a hug or doing jazz hands, the thinking face, and a couple of options signifying quiet. The lying face, of course, takes its basis from the character Pinocchio. Fun sidebar, after the Bible, The Adventures of Pinocchio story from 1883 is the most translated book in history, according to most sources, although occasionally it is placed third. This face conveys silence, and both of these are listed as neutral but often used to share impatience. The grimacing face covers a range of emotions surrounding embarrassment, and this face depicts an eye roll. Interestingly, eye-rolling has been with us for a long time. Early uses include Milton's Paradise Lost and a Shakespeare poem, The Rape of Lucrece. Eye-rolling, at the time, indicated sexual desire and didn't begin to evolve into its current negative connotation until the 1950s. Almost to the end of our generic faces, we find a selection of surprised emojis, followed by a yawn, and a generic sleeping face. The Z's are a common onomatopoeic representation of snoring, although their first use was by Henry David Thoreau to represent the sound of locusts rather than a sleeping person. Other sleepy emojis follow, with this one, also used to express desire, and this, snot bubbles often indicate a character is tired in anime. This face is often thought to show death, but officially is titled Dizzy Face. Next, this one represents the expression zip your lips, or its variants. Various ailments are then represented across these. Next, the money crazy emoji features several dollar signs. While not entirely proven, the most widely accepted origin story of the dollar sign goes back to the Spanish peso, the basic unit of value during late 1700s America. These peso de ocho reales, or pieces of eight, was abbreviated PS, and over time these letters were overlaid to give the approximation of the modern dollar sign. From here, we have a wide range of silly emojis, starting with this cowboy. Next, this brings us to the demon section. There are two variations on the purple devil, and then this guy. This is an oni, a hideous ogre from Japanese folklore. In parts of Japan, men wear oni masks and straw coats on New Year's Eve to ward off evil. This guy isn't a devil either, but rather a tengu, a trickster from Japanese folklore. That brings us to another one of the creepiest emojis, the clown. Of course, we then find ourselves at one of the most popular emojis, the ever-relevant pile of poo. Things get spooky with the ghost and then the two skeletons. The latter depicts the skull and crossbones, popularized by pirate folklore. It was used on military flags as early as the 12th century and became associated with piracy around the 14th. The alien is next and has some interesting backstory. Aliens have been depicted in countless forms, but this kind is called the Gray Alien, or Roswell Gray. 73% of all reported alien encounters describe this iconic type of alien: small, human-like bodies, large, hairless gray heads, and wide, black eyes. The famous Barney and Betty Hill abduction, a couple who claimed to be abducted by extraterrestrials in mid-September of 1961, was the first widely publicized alien abduction and popularized the gray alien design. On the subject of aliens, we next see this, rendered in a pixelated 8-bit style modeled off the popular Space Invaders video game. This robot is modeled off the style of vintage tin robot toys, the first of which is believed to be Lilliput from late 30s Japan. This emoji is particularly evocative of early American toys, such as the Marvelous Mike. Thrown randomly into the mix is the carved pumpkin, a tradition brought to America by Irish immigrants who carved jack-o'-lanterns to ward off spirits. Ancient Celtics didn't have pumpkins, however, so the original jack-o'-lanterns were carved on turnips. The next section is a selection of earlier emojis remade with cat faces. Let's talk hand signals, because emoji covers a ton of them. The palms up may represent American Sign Language's open book sign or Islamic prayer stance, and open hands is similar. Hands are raised and clapped and shook. The recognizable thumbs up and down appears next. Although the precise hand gesture is not entirely verifiable, it is believed the gesture comes from ancient Roman gladiator battles, although not quite in the way you might think. A referee signaled sparing the fighter by pressing a thumb to the top of the fist, and the signal to kill was actually probably a thumbs up. The meaning was accidentally swapped by influential painter Jean-Léon Gérôme because he misunderstood text describing the gesture, a mistake that was echoed by Ridley Scott in Gladiator. Several angles of fist bump are up next, followed by a variety of finger gestures. The common symbol for luck, which may have originated either from an early pagan belief in the powerful symbolism of the cross, the intersection thought to mark a meeting of good spirits, or from the early days of Christianity when practitioners were persecuted for their beliefs and had to develop hand gestures to identify fellow Christians. This symbol represents victory, a World War II rallying emblem. It was continued by Richard Nixon to signal victory in the Vietnam War and became adopted by protesters of the war as a sign of peace. In British culture and some other countries, the gesture becomes equivalent to the American middle finger when flipped away from the viewer.
Jog on.
Continuing with hand signs is the American Sign Language gesture for I love you, not to be confused with the rock on gesture. There's also the OK gesture, which might bring up the 2017 controversy that the symbol was being associated with the white power movement. Users on 4chan flooded social media with this claim, but it remains unclear if claims were genuine or ironic. Quick etymological note on OK because it's a fascinating word. The first usage was on March 23, 1839 in the Boston Morning Post, where it was used as a humorous abbreviation for all correct. The joke, of course, being that to abbreviate it that way, you had to spell both words wrong. The word might then have died, except it got picked up during Martin Van Buren's 1840 presidential campaign, as he was running for re-election. He was from Kinderhook, New York, and so his nickname became Old Kinderhook, or OK. The pinched fingers emoji follows. You might associate it with the oft-stereotyped Italian hand gesture, and that's for a good reason. It genuinely is used in Italy. It's generally used to express disagreement or disbelief, and is known as the ma che vuoi gesture, which literally translates to, what are you saying? The old pinching gesture follows and leads a number of directional points. Somewhat relevant is the interesting 2012 study that found that while chimpanzees, our closest living relative, cannot follow finger points, dogs can, hinting at their unique codependent behavioral evolution. There's also a number of open palms that lead into the split finger salute popularized by Star Trek's Vulcans. This seemingly simple gesture can't actually be performed by everyone. This unfortunately includes actor Zachary Quinto, who played Spock in the 2009 Star Trek film. Allegedly, he had such a difficult time forming the gesture that the filmmakers ended up having to glue his fingers together for scenes where he was meant to do the salute, although Quinto claims this is just a rumor. Regardless, it's not even the first time that a Star Trek actor couldn't do the hand signal. William Shatner, who had a long run as Captain Kirk, wrote in his biography that producers would have to tie his fingers together with fishing wire so he could display the Vulcan sign. The waving hand follows, which apparently can signal the end of a friendship when used over WeChat. The call me hand is also present and is often used as a shaka sign, a common Hawaiian surf greeting, although this gesture is angled differently. The flexed arm symbolizes fitness and its new companion is the flexed mechanical arm. This leads into the infamous middle finger, surprisingly one of the most ancient insult gestures known. The ancient Greeks used the middle finger as an explicit gesture representing the male genitalia. Likely it fell out of favor during the Middle Ages as the Catholic Church would have disapproved of the sexual context. Fun fact, the first use of the middle finger captured on camera is believed to be in this group photo from 1886 where pitcher Charles Radburn can be spotted doing the lewd gesture. The writing emoji is next followed by the prayer emoji. This interpretation is actually a westernization of the gesture. In Japanese culture, two hands pressed together in this way would indicate please or thank you. Next are the foot, the leg, and the prosthetic leg. Moving on to the random assortment of body parts section, we kick things off with a lipstick and the lips it goes on, as well as other mouth parts. There's also an ear and an ear with a hearing aid. The style of aid is behind the ear, which is one of three main styles. The other two are canal and in the ear. The nose follows. Next is, randomly, the footprints, then eyes and brain. A brief silhouette section shows up after that. The following section doesn't have a super interesting breakdown, suffice it to say that there are a number of generic people ranging from babies to the elderly, with a variety of hairstyles and aesthetic choices, all of which can be further customized with skin tones. More interesting is the next section, with a seemingly random selection of occupations and characters to select from. While not across the board, most of these costumes feature several versions across different genders and styles. To synthesize, let's clarify by occupation instead of individual emoji. First is a person wearing a guapi mao, a Chinese hat also known as a skull cap. Next are the emojis wearing turbans, a customary headgear worn predominantly by Sikhs but also observed in other cultures. Following that is the woman in a headscarf, a traditional covering worn by Muslim women. Then we have police officers, all depicted wearing traditional US police uniforms. Police uniforms differ drastically around the globe, but the setup depicted here is typical of the United States. Next up is the construction worker depicted in a hard hat and high visibility vest. This vest was invented by Bob Switzer in the 1930s after he was hurt unloading crates, an injury that unfortunately left his vision too damaged to pursue his dream of becoming a doctor. The next section, of all things, features the Queen's Guard. Although listed as just guard, the distinctive bearskin hat clearly singles these soldiers out as part of the Queen's Guard. Perhaps the most famous rumor about these guards is that they must stand entirely still and ignore tourists regardless of how much they antagonize. This isn't exactly true. The procedure for dealing with irritating tourists begins with stamping and shouting, "Stand back from the Queen's Guard!" If this command isn't followed, the sentry is allowed to point their rifle at the source of the nuisance. If the persistent tourist isn't yet deterred, the guard has the option to either detain the person or summon assistance. What next follows is the detective in classic detective getup, magnifying glass in hand. There's also the generic doctor. And the farmer. Next is the cook, wearing a toque blanche, the formal name for a chef's hat. This hat is credited to French chef Marie-Antoine Caremba, who stiffened an existing design with cardboard. Speaking of crazy hats, the student is wearing a mortarboard cap, which evolved in the 15th century from a beretta, a hat that looks a bit like a takeout box, which was worn by clerics as far back as 1311. The rockstar emojis are up next, followed by the teacher, the factory worker and their welding torch set, and the delightfully vague technologist doing vague tasks on their blatantly Apple laptop. The other careers represented are office worker, mechanic, scientist, artist, firefighter, pilot, astronaut, and judge. This is followed by a bride with new male and gender-neutral options, and groom, also with female and gender-neutral options. Things get a bit more mythical after this, beginning with a princess and prince. Sneaking in amongst the new emojis is the ninja. There's also a selection of generic superheroes and supervillains. Santa Claus, Mrs. Claus, and a gender-neutral variant all make an appearance, followed by some mages, elves, and vampires. The vampires feature the delightfully cute Easter egg that their skin tones can only be changed across varying shades of gray instead of the standard color palette. Representations of zombies, genies, merpeople, fairies, and a cherub are also present. The next section features people engaged in a variety of postures and family groups. There's a pregnant woman and a woman breastfeeding. Interesting to note is that the baby's head is hidden. This is because the skin tone can be changed for this emoji, and the baby's head being hidden means that it doesn't have the restriction of being correlated with the mother's skin tone. This holds true for the new bottle feeding emoji, which appears in male, female, and gender neutral options. These all represent dojeza, a form of bow used in Japan to represent deep apology. It is often misinterpreted as a person doing push-ups or waiting for a massage. The sassy hair flippers and people saying no follow. This group is gesturing okay with their bodies, and these folks have a question. These emoji are signaling deafness by signing deaf in ASL. We then have the face palm and the shrug. Maybe you remember the old text form known as a shruggy. This next one is tough to see unless you scale the emoji up, but features a pout, and similarly, the frown can be seen here when enlarged. A few activities follow. Haircut, massage, and people in a sauna. Saunas have been around for a while, the first written record in 1112 in Finland. Finland loves their saunas. It's estimated that there are as many as 3.3 million saunas for just 5.5 million people. There's even a Burger King that has one. It is technically pronounced sauna, and discounting specialized terms, it is the only widely used Finnish word in the English language. It means bathhouse. Fingernail painting was a common practice by 3000 BC in Egypt, but it is believed to have originated even earlier in China, where nail color indicated social rank. We can see the modern interpretation here. Speaking of modern behavior, next is a person taking a selfie. The woman dancing appears to be doing either a salsa or flamenco, whereas the man is discoing. The bunny ears people are an iteration of the Playboy bunny, known in Japan as a bunny girl. It can also be used to represent the Japanese kimono mimi, a hybrid human animal from anime. And this brings us to one of the most infamous and inexplicable characters on the keyboard. Who is this guy? Why is he floating? Why does he have such a nice suit on? This guy has been routinely categorized as one of the least used emojis, perhaps because nobody knows what he's supposed to be. For context, we have to dive deep back into the 90s, when Webdings was born. A sort of early emoji keyboard, it swapped out your characters for little black and white pictures. Among the many bizarre inclusions was this guy set to the letter M. This levitating man was created by Vincent Conair, most infamous for designing Comic Sans. Just to keep things in the realm of the confusing and bizarre, this Webdings character was based on the mascot for a ska punk record company from the 70s. There's a selection of genders in both non-motorized and motorized wheelchairs. We have people walking both without and with a probing cane, a device used to aid the visually impaired. There's kneeling and running and standing and holding hands. There's kissing in a variety of combinations, and then a family gathering with virtually every arrangement imaginable. This leads us into the clothing section, starting with the basic materials of yarn and thread. The clothes that follow are winter jacket, lab coat, high visibility safety vest, blouse, and polo shirt. Let's take a brief pause here to talk about how the polo shirt wasn't invented for polo, it was invented for tennis. So this is history that you have to take with a grain of salt, because the polo shirt developed from designs created by British soldiers stationed in India, who wanted to refine their uncomfortable shirts to better suit them to the game of polo. These designs were further bettered by Brooks Brothers into the iconic button-down shirt. But credit for the polo is usually given to tennis player Jean-René Lacoste, who redesigned the uncomfortable tennis shirts at the time to help better his performance in the game. He embraced his nickname, the Crocodile, although there are numerous explanations why this nickname came to be, and emblazoned the shirt with his own crocodile logo. This was the very first case of a visible brand logo on clothing. Lacoste wore this shirt to the 1926 US Open Championship, which he won, and this fueled the polo sensation. Next up are jeans, which have enough interesting history for their own episode. Suffice it to say, they've been around much longer than you might think. The blue jeans we think of today were patented by Jacob W. Davis and Levi Strauss on May 20, 1873, but based on a number of earlier inventions. For example, the fabric that they're constructed from was discovered in the 18th century by accident, when people in the town of Nîmes, France, tried to replicate a sturdy Italian fabric called serge. Their creation was titled Serge de Nîmes, of course now shortened to denim. For even more relaxed looks, we have the Speedo and swim shorts. Fun note on Speedo is that it's a popular proprietary eponym, a term describing when a brand name is generalized to describe an entire noun. Some you may know that seem more obvious include Kleenex, Xerox, and Tupperware, but others have become so ingrained in our language that they're almost unrecognizable as once trademarked items. These include granola, linoleum, thermos, pogo stick, yo-yo, frisbee, escalator, and dumpster. Moving into more formal wear is the shirt and tie, as well as the dress. Considerably less formal is the bikini, however. Although we think of bikinis as a modern invention, evidence of bikini-style garments date back to 5,600 BC and have been featured in Roman art pieces. The word itself doesn't actually come from any sort of bikini, bi as in two parts, but rather was named by Louis Rayard, the inventor of the modern bikini, after the Bikini Atoll, where post-war atomic bomb tests were taking place. Next is the Japanese kimono. The word kimono originally just meant clothing, but over time it came to signify this specific article of clothing. There's also the sari, typically worn by women in India and surrounding countries. There are variations, but most often it consists of an unstitched drape. The word sari itself in Sanskrit means strip of cloth, and can be draped in over 100 ways. The most common is called the nivi drape, but there are many regional variations. This section caps off with the one-piece bathing suit before moving more specifically into shoes. There are flats and heels. The tallest commercially available heels have 20-inch heels and come with a health warning that the manufacturer of the shoe cannot be held responsible for any injury clients may sustain while wearing them. There's also the heeled sandal and heeled boot. Next is the standard man's dress shoe. On Emojipedia, the premier catalog for emojis, this shoe contains the amusing and somewhat bitter side note, unlike women's shoes, this shoe is likely to be comfortable, not wrong. Shoes like this can be made of leather, and this is not new. The oldest shoe we are currently aware of is a 5,500-year-old leather one found in an Armenian cave. The running shoe, or sneaker, follows. The name sneaker stems from how quiet the rubber soles were compared to leather-soled dress shoes. The name sneaks had been previously used by prison inmates to describe wardens because of their rubber-soled shoes. The section finishes with a hiking boot. Also footwear related, we have a pair of socks, which transitions us to other similar coverings like gloves and scarves. And now we find ourselves in the accessories, beginning with hats. We start with the top hat. Fun aside about this hat is its history in the context of magic. Almost as recognizable as its headwear function is the magician's tendency to pull rabbits from it. The bright white fur of the rabbit makes it stand out against the black magician's outfit, and the compressibility of a rabbit, it looks much longer stretched out than it is while sitting, makes them perfect for this illusion. We have Mary Toft to thank for this classic trick. In 18th century England, she was struggling to make ends meet. During this time, oddities shows were very popular, and so she decided to convince people that she had given birth to a litter of rabbits. To do this, she put rabbit parts under her skirt and pretended to give birth. The illusion was apparently so convincing that doctors across Europe and even the King of Wales bought it until she was eventually caught sneaking rabbits into her room. By the time she was exposed, however, news of the feat had spread and people had begun to think of rabbits as magic animals. The rabbit from a top hat trick was first attempted in 1814 by French magician Louis Comte, although the credit often goes to John Henry Anderson, whose adept marketing skills helped spread the image of pulling rabbits from hats via wooden posters he created. The next hat is the baseball cap, which was initially made of straw and worn by the New York Knickerbockers on April 24, 1849. Within a few years, the visor, or bill, was added. Next is the hat with a bow, and then the mortarboard with a tassel. We mentioned this hat a little bit earlier on, but it's worth diving in a bit deeper into some of its weird traditions. The cap and gown tradition can be traced back to medieval European universities, and historians believe the tradition, in part, was started because graduations took place in large, cold churches, so the gown would have helped keep students warm. The tassel is also significant, although its usage varies by area and even by school. Many universities hold the tradition that the tassel begins on one side and flips to the other after the student receives a diploma. Speaking of mortarboard cap traditions, one of the most iconic images of this hat is the collective toss at the end of graduation. This tradition began in Annapolis, Maryland in 1912 and was started by U.S. Naval Academy students. Up until 1912, students were required to serve 2 more years as midshipmen before being commissioned Navy officers and therefore needed to hold on to their hats. The 1912 class was the first to be commissioned directly at graduation and therefore could toss their hats in a celebratory shedding instead. The rescue worker's helmet follows and features a cross, commonly worn in Japanese construction zones as a safety reminder and familiar to Mega Man fans for its ironic appearance on one of the game's villains. The Met wears this indestructible hard hat that makes them invincible while hiding beneath it. Following this are the glamorous crown and diamond ring. As expensive as these items can get, the records are smashed by the United Kingdom's crown jewels and the pink star diamond alike. The crown jewels are a selection of ceremonial regalia that have been protected in England's Tower of London for over 600 years and include a wide variety of valuable objects that are officially priceless, but as they are uninsured, have likely never been appraised. Estimates place the entire collection at a startling $4 billion, which includes St. Edward's crown with a likely value of $39 million alone. The pink star diamond is even more extravagantly priced. It sold at auction in 2017 for $71.2 million, making it the most valuable ring and gemstone ever sold. 4 years earlier, it had actually sold for $10 million higher to the diamond cutter Isaac Wolfe, who spectacularly defaulted on the bid, leaving the diamond to sit in Sotheby's inventory for several extra years. Also sometimes pricey, in the case of the record-breaking 1001 Knights diamond purse valued at a cool $3.8 million, are handbags. Presented in a slightly more accessible fashion here are several types. The clutch bag, purse, and handbag all make an appearance, as does the briefcase. For expanded carrying needs, we need to turn to the backpack and luggage. To help you see what you're carrying, we have a few types of eyewear, starting with glasses and then sunglasses. If you've ever walked into a Sunglass Hut, you might have been overwhelmed by the huge variety of high-end name brands, but there's actually less choice than you might think. Eyeglass conglomerate Luxottica owns a startling number of name brands, accounting for 60% of all US sunglass sales. These include Persil, Oliver Peoples, Oakley, Chanel, Prada, Tiffany & Co., Versace, Ralph Lauren, Paul Smith, Coach, Vogue, Valentino, DKNY, Michael Kors, Polo, Brooks Brothers, Burberry, and Ray-Ban. Oh, and they also own the Sunglass Hut. If that blazing list hurt your eyes, you may need some protective lab goggles. Finally, to conclude the smileys and people section on an irrelevant note, we have a lone closed umbrella, apparently because there's no other place to stick it. Of course, this barely scratches the surface. We also have animals and nature, food and drink, activity, travel and places, objects, symbols, and flags to get through. We'll pick back up this extensive and diverse collection in part 2, but until then, thanks for joining us.